Word2Vec is a technique in computer science that allows you to do mathematics with the word. For example, you can give this equation to a computer, which will be something like king minus man plus woman, and computer will tell you the answer is queen. What? Isn't that mind-boggling? This is super cool, and it works really well, and I'm not making this up. So how can computer do this? Well, think about this. Computers don't understand text, so they understand numbers. So if there is a way to represent a word king in a number such that it can accurately represent the meaning of the word king. Now that number cannot be one number, so you need to have set of numbers, and in mathematics, set of numbers are called vectors. So let's think about this. How about we represent word king into a vector, which is just a bunch of numbers, such that it can represent the meaning of word king accurately. Now think about king. King has a different properties, or there are different ways of representing the word king. For example, king has authority. King is rich, usually. King has a gender of male, okay? Does king have a tail? No, generally horse will have a tail, right? So that answer will be zero. So what if we do this? All right, so for authority, we'll give number one. For tail, we'll give number zero because king doesn't have tail. For being rich, we'll give number one. One meaning super rich, zero meaning very poor. And for gender, let's say we give number minus one. Minus one is male and one is female. Now we came up with this vector 101-1 that represents the meaning of word king. You can do similar thing with another word, for example, horse. For horse, the property tail will be one, but the other properties such as authority, being rich, etc. will be close to zero. And if you do this for all type of different words in your vocabulary, you will be able to do a math. So let me just show you a very simple example here. Let's say I have a story of king and queen, and I want to represent all the words in that story with word vectors. Here I have different properties such as authority, event, has tail, and so on. And let's say there is a word called battle. For battle, battle is an event, so that value is 1, remaining values are 0. Horse has a tail, that's why it's 1. Horse might have little authority, 0.01. Horse might be a little rich, 0.1, if it is a horse of a king. So, and gender is 1. Here, like, values might not be 0, because I'll tell you the reason behind that a little later. But when you have king, we already saw, it's 1001-1. And for different words, you can come up with these different type of vectors. And once you have the vectors, you can do the mathematics. So now when I do king minus man plus woman, just do a simple math. 1 minus 0.2 plus 0.2 is 1. 0, 0. I'm taking individual elements, okay? 1 minus 0.3 is 0.7 plus 0.2, 0.9. And that result vector is similar to a vector of queen. It is not exactly the same, but it's quite similar, right? 0.9 and 1, that's the only difference. So you already saw how that math works. When you give this equation to computer, computer will be able to tell you that the answer is queen. And that is pretty powerful. Now, you don't want to hand code all these properties for all these words. Let's say you're doing natural language processing for all the text on Wikipedia. There are so many thousands of words. And to come up with these kind of properties for each of these words will be very, very difficult. So you don't want to handcraft it. In computer programming, you can use basically neural networks to learn these feature vectors. So these numbers are called feature vectors, okay? So authority, event, has tail are called features in the language of machine learning. And using neural networks, you can learn these feature vectors. You don't have to hand code it. So let's see how that is done. And by the way,
when you learn these feature vectors, one interesting thing that will happen is you will not know what these feature vectors are. You will not know that this one means authority, but it will all work magically. So what you do is you take a fake problem and you try to solve it using neural network, and as a side effect, you get word embedding. Now, what does that mean? So what is the fake problem? Let's say the fake problem is you want to find a missing word in a sentence. That's your fake problem. Well, the problem is real, but our goal is not to learn what is the missing word in a sentence. Our goal is to learn word embedding as a side effect. Say there is a story of great King Ashoka. You know, he was the king in India in ancient times. And when you're reading this story, you can take a fake problem, which is complete this sentence. So here, when I say order his minister, see, based on this text, this mighty king order his minister, the emperor order his minister, I can say the missing word is king or emperor. And when I give this task of filling in the missing word to a computer, as a side effect, this is a very important keyword, side effect. As a side effect, it will learn the vectors for king and emperor. These are those feature vectors. And once you have vectors, you can do math. You can say king is almost equal to emperor. So see, you will be able to derive the synonyms, the antonyms. You can do math, such as king minus man plus woman is equal to queen, and so on. So now let's look into this problem a little further. For example, you have this sentence: eating something is very healthy. And if I ask you to fill in the missing word, well, most likely you will say apple and walnut, because that's food and that's healthy. Pizza is also food, but it's not healthy, so you won't fill it. And forget truck. Eating truck is very healthy. Are you crazy? Similarly, when you have the sentence, the likely keyword will be rocket. You are not going to say NASA launched pizza last month. So now, when you are in this process of finding out the missing word, you realize one fact, which is meaning of a word can be inferred by surrounding words. If someone gives you surrounding words, so these surrounding words are also called context. So based on the context, you can figure out what that missing word is. So now let's take this paragraph and we will try to auto-complete those missing words. And auto-completing missing words is really not the area of our interest. It is our fake problem. Our area of interest is to learn the word embeddings, the vectors which can represent those words. So I will parse this paragraph and I will take a window of three words. And here I will say, if I have a word lived and a, I can predict that there is a word there. So I'm taking the second and third word and trying to predict the first word. And these are my training samples. So I can move that window of three words throughout the paragraph, generate all these training samples. You see, I generated all these training samples. And now this becomes a training set for neural network. So the words on the left hand side are my X, the word on the right hand side are my Y. And you feed X into neural network and you want it to predict the word Y. Now, if you have not seen my neural network video, please go watch it. You need to have some understanding of neural network in order to understand things which I am going to explain in this video. So if you don't know already what is neural network, pause the video right now. I'm going to provide my neural network video link in a video description below. So just get some basic understanding. Assuming you have the basic understanding now, let's go back to our problem, which is you have training samples. And by the way, this problem is called self-supervised because all you had was this paragraph. You did not have like X and Y. You had a paragraph. From that paragraph, you generated these training samples. Now let's try to train our neural network using each of these training samples. So let's say my first sample is order his. So order his is an input. Based on that, you want to predict word king, which is an output. Now you can build a neural network that looks something like this. The input layer will have a one hot encoded vector. So let's say there are 5,000 words in my vocabulary. Then there will be a vector of size 5,000 and only one of them will be one. So if the word is ordered, the value of order will be one and remaining numbers will be zero. And same thing is for his. See, his is one and remaining numbers are zero. And the size of this vector is, let's say, 5,000. 5,000 is, let's say, vocabulary. Vocabulary means unique words in your text corpus or in the, you know, text problem that you're trying to solve. And in the hidden layer, here I have put four neurons. And these four neurons are the size of my embedding vector. Now, size of embedding vector could be anything. Like, there is no golden rule. I just selected four, but it's a hyperparameter to your neural network. It could be 5, 10, 200, anything. This is something you learn using trial and error. In the output layer, I will have 5,000 size vector. And when I feed this training sample into my neural network, what happens is these weights or the ages will have random weights. So using random weights, it will predict some output which will be wrong most likely. King is the right output. So you all know how neural network works, how back error propagation works. You compare your actual output, which is Y, with your predicted output Y hat. You take a loss. So loss is a difference between your predicted output and actual output, and you back propagate. Again, if you don't know about back propagation, I have some videos, you can check it out. But when you back propagate, essentially what you're doing is you are adjusting all these weights, and then you take a second sample, third sample, you take all 10,000 or 1 million samples, and your goal is to train a network in such a way that when you input order his, the network accurately finds out that it is a king. So you expect one to be here. Actually, you expect in the emperor here also, you expect it to be one because it could be anything. Now you take the second sentence, which is emperor ordered his. And you're not taking the whole sentence. You're taking a window of size 3. It could be window of size 4, 5, depends on you, how you want to experiment. But same thing happens here where you feed an input, the neural network will find out the output, it will compare it with the actual output, there is a loss and it will backpropagate. And it takes the third sentence, you know, from Kalinga and battle, you're trying to predict that the missing word is after. Same thing. There is predicted output, actual output, loss, backpropagation. And eventually, when you have done, you are done feeding your, let's say 1 million elements, and let's say you run 10 or 15 or 50 epochs and your neural network is trained, at that point the word vector for king would be these weights w1, w2, w3, w4. So those weights are nothing but a trained word vector, and this vector will be very similar to a vector of emperor. So the vector for the emperor will be w5, w6, w7, w8. Just think about it. It will be similar because the input is same. So here, order and his, both for king and emperor, the input is same. So when the input is same, you expect that these weights will also be similar. And hence the vector for king and emperor will be very similar using this approach. This approach is called continuous bag of words. So here you have a context, which is order his. And based on that context, you are trying to predict target, which is king. There is a second methodology called skipgram. In skipgram, we do reverse. We have a target word king, and based on that, we try to predict order his. Again, predicting target from context and context from target, these are fake problems. You know, we are not interested in solving this problem. But while we solve those problems, as a side effect, we get word embeddings. So we are more interested in learning word embeddings. just to summarize, Word2Vec is not a single method, but it could be using one of the two techniques, which is either continuous back of words or skip gram, to learn word embeddings. See, the word Word2Vec means convert word to a vector. So Word2Vec is a revolutionary invention in the field of computer science, which allows you to represent words in a vector in a very accurate way, so that you can do mathematics with it. Let's talk about skipgram. So in skipgram, I have inverted my neural network diagram. So here you can see it's exactly reversed than the CBOR. Here you have the word king. Based on that, you're trying to predict order his. And you will do the same thing. You will feed one sentence, calculate the expected output, compare it with the actual output, do back propagation, and so on. And in that process, you learn the word embeddings for each of these words. You know, there are 5,000 words, let's say, in our vocabulary. So the embedding for Ashoka will be W1 to W4. The embedding would be for Emperor would be W6 to W9. So when you're using skipgram, the word embedding is a layer between the input layer and the hidden layer. In the CBOR, it was the weights between hidden layer and the output layer. You can do wonderful things with Word2Vec, such as USA minus Washington DC plus Delhi. Do you have any guess? Pause the video. This is a quiz for you. Well, it is India. Okay, any guess on this one? Wow, you all are so smart. Yes, Apple. So computers can do this kind of mathematics. This works really well. I took this diagram from this Tour Science article. You can represent these vectors in a vector space. So here I'm showing you three-dimensional vector space. That could be n-dimensional vector space. And you know, using a method called Tisney, you can chain that n-dimensional vector space to two-dimensional vector space. And you will find that the word, the relationship between walking and walked will be similar to swimming and swam. So once you have learned this relationship, when you give a word swimming to a computer, it will tell you the output is swam. It can also figure out a relationship. Basically, it will say, okay, whatever is Madrid to Spain, the same thing is Rome to Italy. So it can learn these kind of complex relationships. So that was all the theory behind Word2Vec. I hope you like this video. If you did, please share it with your friends who are confused about word embeddings, Word2Vector. And if you have any question, post in a video comment below. In the next video, we will be looking at the coding part, where using Python, we will see how Word2Vec works, and we'll run some code to see this magic in works. Thank you.